Are you wondering what fertility treatment options are available and how they actually work? Whether you're just asking questions or deep into your family building journey, the options can feel overwhelming. Today, I'm going to break it down clearly what options are available to you to help you feel empowered on your family building journey. I'm Dr. Lora Shahine, a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist, helping people build families and navigate fertility treatment options for over 20 years. If this is the first time finding the channel, welcome. I am so glad that you're here. Be sure and subscribe to get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. Two other ways to stay in touch and learn: my weekly newsletter, link in the description below. You get fertility in the news, educational content, and some recommendations each week. Another way to learn is my Brave and Curious podcast. You can listen anywhere you listen to podcasts, weekly episodes with interviews with experts in the field, and a deep dive into reproductive health and wellness topics. Now, today we are talking about fertility treatment options. Fertility treatments are not a one-size-fits-all path for anyone. My goal for today is for you to have a clear understanding of what the options are and how they work, so you can feel empowered to ask your doctor questions about your next steps. Now, we're going to go over four main topics today: fertility medications, intrauterine insemination, IVF, and lifestyle optimization, because I believe the more reproductively healthy you are, the faster you're gonna meet your goal, whether you're doing fertility treatment options I outline here or not. First, we're gonna talk about fertility treatment medications. Now, medications can either be oral medications or injection medications. These are either oral medications include clomiphene or Clomid, or letrozole or Femara. So Clomid and Femara are the brand names. Clomiphene and Letrozole are the generic names. Both of these medications are pills that you take at the beginning of your cycle to induce ovulation. They work in different ways. Clomid actually blocks estrogen receptors in your brain, so your body thinks you're low in estrogen, and it helps induce gonadotropin production from your pituitary gland to help talk to your ovary to help recruit and mature and ovulate eggs. Letrozole is an aromatase inhibitor. Aromatase is an enzyme that converts androgens to estrogen. So it too makes the body think that you're low in estrogen and encourages production of these gonadotropins from the pituitary gland to talk to the ovary to get it to recruit and mature an egg. You have to ovulate, release an egg from your ovary in order to get pregnant. It's got to get into the fallopian tube, meet the sperm. Fertilization has to happen, the embryo has to develop and implant into the uterus. So these pills are helping your body do that egg recruitment and maturation process. It's really helpful for people that are not ovulating regularly. And the way you know you're ovulating or not is honestly how regular your periods are. I've got multiple videos here on what is a regular menstrual cycle and how to tell if you're ovulating or not. This is Fertility 101. You have got to be releasing an egg about once a month in order to have the opportunity of getting pregnant. And so if you're having a period about once a month, that's a really good clue that you're ovulating about once a month. People who don't know when they're ovulating, people with polycystic ovarian syndrome or hormonal issues that can be disrupting ovulation, they will take them longer to conceive because it's hard to tell when they're ovulating. It's hard to time intercourse. And so medications like Clomid and Letrozole can help with that process and help people achieve pregnancy sooner. Now, there are injection medications that are used for fertility treatment. These are bypassing the tricking of the body into thinking estrogen levels are lower. That's what the pills are doing. So remember, Clomid and Letrozole fool your body into thinking that estrogen levels are low to get your pituitary gland to make gonadotropins to talk to the egg. Well, you can actually give the body directly gonadotropins and bypass the estrogen induction or bypass the pituitary gland totally. So you can give follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. These are both gonadotropins that are made from the pituitary gland to talk to the ovary to mature and ovulate eggs. And so instead of giving pills to help the body emphasize its process, you can just give gonadotropins in the form of injections. So if somebody is doing IVF, for example, when people talk about doing the shots that are leading up to an egg retrieval, you are bypassing the pituitary gland and just giving the body, and the ovaries are seeing a higher level of gonadotropins in order to recruit multiple eggs. So you can use these shots or these gonadotropins either with the goal of trying, you know, intercourse at home or an intrauterine insemination, or these are the medications that are used in IVF when you're trying to get multiple eggs to mature and come out of the body to help fertilize in the lab. So let's recap. There are fertility medications that are used for fertility treatment. They can be either pills like Clomid or Letrozole, or shots, gonadotropins, which can be follicle stimulating hormone or luteinizing hormone. These medications work in different ways. In general, the pills are used to help induce ovulation by tricking the body into making more of its own gonadotropins from the pituitary gland. And the shots are gonadotropins that are just delivered directly into the system, bypassing the pituitary gland and helping that ovulation and maturation occur with inside the body. There are pros and cons to each of these medications. Talk to your doctor about which one is right for you. The second fertility treatment I want to talk about today is IUI, or intrauterine insemination. There are so many acronyms in my field. IUI, intrauterine insemination. This is considered a low-tech fertility treatment option because it is processing the sperm outside of the body, isolating the motile best sperm, and placing that sperm into the uterine cavity around the time of ovulation. So intrauterine inseminations can be used for lots of different reasons. It could be used in the setting of donor sperm. It could be used in the setting of the treatment of a male factor fertility. It could be a treatment for unexplained infertility. There are many benefits to intrauterine insemination. It's usually can be combined with medications to help with ovulation, maybe even ultrasounds or ovulation predictor kits to know exactly when ovulation is happening. And then the process of washing, isolating the best sperm and getting it past the cervix can be helpful and improve chances of getting pregnant. It's hard, you can't really diagnose a cervical factor, but I do think the process of getting the sperm past the cervix can be helpful. Cervix is a natural filter. It helps isolate motile sperm from the rest of the stuff that comes out in the ejaculate. And I do think sometimes people's cervix does too good of a job. So washing, prepping, getting the best sperm into the uterine cavity closer to the goal, which is the egg that should be in the fallopian tube, can up chances of conceiving. I describe IUI as a low-tech fertility treatment option for my patients because we are controlling certain variables. Sometimes we're using medications to induce ovulation. Sometimes we're monitoring the uterine lining and optimizing for ovulation with an ultrasound. But we, at the end of the day, we are just placing sperm into the uterine cavity. And we're hopeful. There's a lot of stuff and steps that have to happen after that. So you still have to have that egg ovulate, get into the fallopian tube. Egg and sperm have to find each other, like each other. Fertilization has to happen. The embryo has to develop and then make it all the way down into the uterine cavity to implant. So it's low tech because still all of those steps are still happening inside the body. And as I mentioned before, IUI can be used in lots of different settings, most commonly used for donor sperm inseminations, mild male factor, and unexplained infertility. The third fertility treatment option I want to talk about is IVF. IVF is in vitro fertilization. And when I'm comparing it to IUI, I say IVF is the high-tech option. This is totally different from intrauterine inseminations or IUI. In IVF, we are giving gonadotropins to recruit multiple eggs in one cycle. We are getting the eggs outside of the body with a simple procedure called an egg retrieval. We're helping eggs and sperm fertilize in the lab. That's why it's called in vitro fertilization. Fertilization is happening in the lab, in vitro. We watch the embryos develop in the lab, and then from there, we can either do a fresh embryo transfer, we can freeze embryos at this point, we can even biopsy embryos to do genetic screening on them for chromosome issues or single gene mutations. but this process I describe as high tech to my patients because, unlike with intrauterine inseminations, everything that's happening inside the body, everything is really happening outside of the body. And when we have the embryo ready to conceive, whether it's 5 days after the egg retrieval or after it's been frozen for a few weeks, a few years, we can thaw the embryo and place it into the uterine cavity. So I tell patients, you know, the reason IVF was invented and it was used in the first patients was for tubal disease. So if the tubes are blocked, you can do as many IUIs as you want, intrauterine inseminations, but the egg and sperm can't find each other because the tubes are blocked. IVF was invented for people with blocked fallopian tubes. It's doing what usually happens in the fallopian tube, but in the lab, fertilization in the lab, not fertilization in the tube. And then when the embryo is ready, I say we're putting it in through a different door. So we're placing the embryo into the uterine cavity through the cervix, and you don't even need fallopian tubes to get pregnant with IVF. People do IVF for many reasons. We already talked about tubal factor or blocked fallopian tubes or missing fallopian tubes as an indication for IVF. Sometimes people do it for significant male factor. Sometimes people don't have enough sperm to even have success with a low-tech treatment like intrauterine insemination. Some people use IVF for unexplained infertility, endometriosis. People use it for fertility preservation. Sometimes people are freezing eggs or creating and freezing embryos at a young age or before a chemotherapy treatment or with diagnosis of a chronic disease. They're not ready to start their family, but they don't want to lose their fertility in the future. So they're freezing eggs and embryos for use later in life. So there are many different reasons to do IVF. Let me recap a little bit, because when I'm talking to my patients about what the options are, I basically say, hey, first thing that we're going to do is testing to make sure I'm not missing something that we should focus on. Because if your fallopian tubes are blocked, we're probably going to be going to IVF. If you've got a mild male factor and you're ovulating, we're probably going to do IUIs. You know, it really depends on the patient's situation and their goals. Sometimes patients who are starting the family later in life, they definitely want more than one child. Sometimes they're going to IVF sooner rather than later because they're using it not only as a way to get pregnant now, but by freezing embryos or eggs for the future, they're keeping their fertility options open. Other reasons people use IVF is because they're using egg donor to create embryos to conceive with, or they're creating embryos that they're going to use in the gestational carrier. So there are lots of different reasons to do IVF or high-tech fertility treatment. And before I get into lifestyle optimization as a fourth fertility treatment option, let's just recap. We talked about medications and we talked about IUI versus IVF. And when I'm talking to patients about fertility treatment options, I'm saying, look, there's the basics. We got to do the testing and see if there's anything to focus on. And if the testing is pretty reassuring, there's low-tech options and there's high-tech options. If we're focusing on an issue, like if someone's not ovulating, we could probably keep it pretty simple by giving oral medications to help them ovulate and just time sperm exposure. If someone has blocked fallopian tubes, they're probably going to be going to IVF sooner rather than later. Sometimes we think about a laparoscopy to do more investigation, but honestly, tubal disease is why IVF was invented. A lot of times people get this unexplained infertility. There's no clear reason. And so people are thinking about, well, should I do IUIs or should I do IVF? Each situation is unique. I say the most common path is people do 3 or 4 intrauterine inseminations. And if they are not successful, then they do IVF. That pass is typical because IUIs are less invasive, less complicated, significantly less expensive. And if it's successful, that's wonderful. You have met your goal without having to do IVF. Of course, there are reasons that people go to IVF sooner than doing multiple intrauterine inseminations. And you just have to talk to your doctor about which path is right for you. A really important thing to discuss with your doctor is your family goals. If you want to have 3 or 4 kids, your fertility doctor needs to know that because you might have a different strategy getting started. The fourth treatment option I want to talk about is lifestyle optimization. I talk to all of my patients about this. I have a whole playlist on YouTube where I'm just talking about overall health and habits to stop and habits to start. I feel like it is so important to focus on your overall health and well-being in order to improve your reproductive health. And this is important whether you're doing high-tech fertility treatment like IVF or not. Even if you're doing IVF, being reproductively healthy is going to improve your chances of success. And so I think big picture, I think about nutrition, exercise, sleep, and stress management. Those are the four pillars that I think about. Got lots of individual videos on YouTube that talk about each one. Big picture is to everything in moderation. I feel like sometimes you can feel so out of control on your fertility journey that a way to be good or to try to make fertility your number one goal is to remove things that you enjoy. And that is not a way to live. I think everything in moderation, we all know how to be healthy. You know, the one diet that's been associated with the highest chance of conception is a Mediterranean diet. Why? Well, it's full of fresh fruits and vegetables, some animal protein, but not too much red meat. So exercise, very important. Don't give up exercise, but you don't want to push yourself to extremes. It's not a time to start training for a marathon if you've never done one in your whole life. But if you're pretty athletic, you can probably keep up with what you're doing. And it is important to move your body. If you're not, even just walking 30 minutes three times a week can be very helpful for improving insulin resistance, metabolic issues, your sleep, so important. Thinking about habits, no smoking, no vaping, absolutely detrimental to eggs and sperm. Alcohol, it's not great. It's a huge part of our social fabric. Moderation, not every day and not large quantities. Marijuana, really easy to feel like, well, it must be healthy because it's from a plant. Got two videos here talking about its detrimental impacts to eggs and miscarriage risk, as well as sperm. So be very thoughtful and certainly should not be done on a regular basis. I just want to emphasize that taking care of your health is so important, and it has to go in tandem with fertility treatments if that's what you decide to do with your fertility doctor. So let's recap. We talked about fertility treatment options today. We talked about medications, including pills and injectable medications, intrauterine insemination, IVF, and lifestyle optimization, which is key for no matter what path that you choose. I hope you found this information valuable. Share it with a friend that you know is thinking about fertility journey and would love to have a summary of what treatment options are available. Be sure and like this video if you learned something, comment with questions that you have, subscribe to this channel so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And until next week, wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.